Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes, a ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher today is the director of Bible Tracts Incorporated, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample packet of all of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. And now for our Bible study, here's our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
How do you do, my friend? Welcome to the Tuesday edition here. It's Tract and Truth Tuesday here at Bible Tract Echoes. Yes, it's Tuesday. Now, if you are a regular listener to the program, you know that typically we open our Bibles and we walk through books of the Bible, studying the books verse by verse. And right now we are in a study of Romans chapters 1, 2, and 3, but it is Tuesday, and on our Tuesday broadcast, we willfully and deliberately put our verse-by-verse study aside to try and strengthen one another in our work at telling the gospel and sharing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus gave the commission to his disciples. It's been passed on to us. We are to take the gospel into all the world. We are to give the gospel to every person. And to that end, we try to use our Tuesday broadcast to strengthen our verbal telling of the gospel one-on-one with people, but also strengthen our ability to even do more with the gospel by encouraging one another in using gospel tracts. Do you know what a gospel tract is? Have you ever given somebody a gospel tract? Well, we want to help with that even today. Now, I have my Bible in front of me. I've got about three or four different places involved. I'll probably not have you turn to one, but if you wanted to open your Bible with me, I would encourage you to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, I will get to that verse at the end of the broadcast. I want to lead into the broadcast this way, if I can. I want to ask you this question. Have you ever baked a cake from scratch? Have you ever baked a cake from scratch? I mean, you did not use a box mix. No, you got flour from the store. You got some eggs from the store. And if you were going to make a chocolate cake, then you got some baking powder, chocolate powder, or you melted some chocolate, baking chocolate. And so you put all the ingredients in, you made it from scratch. Have you ever done that? Well, if you were to ask me, say, Brother Mark, have you ever baked a cake from scratch? My answer is no. But you know what? I think if you gave me a good, decent recipe, I could make a cake from scratch. Now, why in the world am I telling you this? Well, a while ago, I was sharing the gospel with a very religious, very moral lady. I mean, her life was a tremendous... Well, you could picture her life like a beautifully decorated cake. It was gorgeous. It was beautiful from every direction that man could look. But then we had to begin to tell her about God and what God expected her. No, God does want everybody to do good, righteous works. As I was sharing the gospel with her, I used my cake story. And as I moved through it, she got the point. And maybe you can use this story, too, as you are trying to share the gospel with very moral, upstanding people, but yet people who do not have Christ as Savior. That's where we're headed today. Get your Bible open, if you want to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30. I have a gospel tract in my hand. Now, friend, I hope you are in the business of using gospel tracts. A gospel tract is a short, written presentation of God's plan of salvation. They're beautifully done. They're designed in a format that's easy to carry with you and easy to hand out. I think the best gospel tract ever invented is you and I, who know Christ, living a godly, wholesome, winsome life, talking eyeball to eyeball with somebody, verbally telling them the gospel. I think you and I are the best gospel tract God could have. But since you and I cannot take the time, we don't have the time to stop with every person we meet, we come up with evangelism tools that help us extend our witness. And a gospel tract is just that. The gospel tract in my hand right now is entitled, The Best I Can. The Best I Can. And it talks about a man trying to, from standing on the shore of New York City, his plan is to swim in his own strength all the way to London. Oh, friend, are you going to make it that far? Do you think any person could swim that far? The answer is no. In this story, somebody offers to buy a man a plane ticket, but he says, no, I'm going to do the best I can. Well, he's going to do the best he can. He's going to end up drowning in the Atlantic Ocean. So many people think if they do the best they can, they're going to be able to get into heaven. God will accept them. This gospel tract lays out with clarity that our best good works are not sufficient. We can't just do the best we can and think that God will accept us. We need a Savior. Here's a good, clear gospel tract, The Best I Can. What I'd love to give you is a sample packet containing one each of all of our English gospel tracts. There's 40 of them. For me to give you that sample packet, I need your name and address. At the end of this broadcast, my announcer will give you three ways by which you can give to us your name and mailing address. If you'll do that, we'll send you that sample packet free of charge. If you cannot stay to the end of the program, you can go to our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org, and you can order that sample packet from the website. Well, let's come back to my cake baking story here today, hopefully to strengthen each other in our verbally telling the gospel. Let me begin by giving you three verses that I think, these are three among many, that I think will help clarify that salvation is by grace, not by works. One is Romans 11:6. Romans 11:6 says this, "And if by grace," speaking of salvation, "if by grace, then it's no more of works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. But if it, salvation, be of works, then it's no more of grace. Otherwise, works is no more works." You see, works and grace are mutually exclusive. Here's a familiar set of verses, Ephesians 2:8 and 9. "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." One more, 2 Timothy 1:9 says this, "Who," speaking of God, "who hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began." Salvation is by grace, not of works, lest any man should boast. Let me come back to my cake illustration. As I was talking and sharing the gospel with this very moral, upstanding, religious lady, I said, "Suppose you are, I've never baked a cake before, but you're an intelligent person and you've been handed a great recipe from an expert baker and you've been told to go bake the cake. Could you do it?" Well, she said, "I think I can." I said, "So far, so good. But suppose I place you so you're standing in the middle of the Sahara Desert. You have the recipe in your hand, but there's no kitchen. There's no flour. There's no eggs. There's nobody around." I said, "Will you be able to bake the cake now?" "No," she said. When I asked why, she said, "I'm standing in the middle of the Sahara Desert." I said, "You're right. You're standing in the wrong place. But now suppose I somehow transport you to the most lavish kitchen in the world. In this kitchen, there are three ovens. There's all kinds of pots and pans and baking utensils and stirring utensils and so on. And there is a beautiful refrigerator, well-stocked pantry. All the ingredients you could ever want are there." I said to the lady, "Now, can you bake the cake?" "Yes," she said. I said, "Wait a minute. What's the difference?" "Well, the difference," she said, "is I'm now standing in this well-supplied kitchen." She was getting the point. Well, I told the story, as I said, to the lady, and she was laughing, and because, well, the story gets a little bit ludicrous, but I was wanting to get to the gospel. I went on and told her, I said, "Yes, God has asked all people to do works that are righteous and good and pleasing to him. But to do these works that are declared good by God, to try to do them without Jesus as our Savior, is like trying to bake a cake while standing in the Sahara Desert. It's impossible because, well, if you're standing in the Sahara Desert, I asked the lady, how long would your eggs remain usable? She said, not very long. How well would your flour hold up? Not well at all, I said. I said, in the Sahara Desert, you lack the supplies required to make a cake, that pleases God. I showed this lady that until she receives Christ as her Savior, she was like a lady standing in the middle of the Sahara Desert. Her life was like a cake, but a cake with no God ingredients in it. To please God required the right ingredients. But these ingredients are not found anywhere except in Jesus Christ. Only after she would come to Christ would she be able to be removed from the desert of her sin into the lavish supply of God's house. She grasped this picture. She knew what it was like to try to bake a cake without the right ingredients or no ingredients at all. I explained to her that her sin made her life empty of righteousness and holiness, but that these are required ingredients by God to be accepted in His sight. She was trying to bake a pleasing cake for God with her life, but her ingredients were all spoiled and rotten because they came out of her own life's pantry, who is sin-tainted and not out of God's kitchen. I turned her attention to 1 Corinthians 1:30 and showed her that only in Christ could she have God's righteousness. Here's what 1 Corinthians 1:30 it says, "But of Him, of God, are ye in Christ Jesus." God has to put us in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. I explained from the verse as we walk through it that God has to give us the ingredients. The ingredients are found in His Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus gives us the wisdom. Jesus gives us the righteousness. Jesus gives us the sanctification. And Jesus gives us the redemption. Without these things, we cannot please God, but they're only found in Jesus Christ. I spent some time dealing with the fact of her personal sinfulness, because that's an issue that she had not really grappled with before. I used the idea that her life, because of her own sin, made her life before God like the Sahara Desert. She understood the illustration. She got the point. She prayed to receive Jesus Christ, to trust Him and not her good works, to cleanse her life from all unrighteousness. Oh, dear friend, reaching morally upright people can be a difficult thing. Perhaps this illustration can be something you can use, but I need to ask you right now, where are you standing right now in your relationship with God? Are you trying to offer God your good works and saying, God, I baked a cake for you. Look how nice it is. But you're baking it out of standing in the Sahara Desert of your own sinfulness. Without Jesus as your Savior, you have no ingredients. You must go to Him and get them by God's grace.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes, a ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of all of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. That's 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. A faster way to contact us is to go to our website at BibleTracksInc.org. That's BibleTracksInc.org. There you will find more information about our ministry and details on how you can support Bible Tracts Incorporated. Thanks for listening, and may the Lord richly bless you as you serve Him.